Wonderful. So first of all, sorry for this little technical problems, but I think we have now worked it out, and welcome to Kaunas. It's really a big pity for me to not to be part of you and your exciting and attractive meeting. It's really a big pity, as said, but unfortunately I had some very important faculty issues here. But my welcome greetings here from Innsbruck to the heart of, from the heart of the Alps to Kaunas, and maybe next time I can be with you. Yeah, I would like to thank the organizers. I hope that you can hear me. If not, please just interrupt me and let me know if I'm too fast or not loud enough. Please let me know, okay? Perfect. So I would like to thank the organizers to have the opportunity to share results from our lab, and also to give you a more broad introduction into the cellular therapy for the treatment of neurological diseases. And actually, I would like to start with an overview which shows you some of the potential, one must say, applications for in the nervous system that might be applicable to for stem cell application. And so I just have to find the pointer. So maybe I start left-hand side. You see that stem cells can be used for cell replacement therapy, and that's in particular in the whole central and peripheral nervous system, to because they can give rise to
Can I
neurons and
just interrupt
synapses.
you, Professor
Wait
Inhofer?
for that. Yeah, so you see a left-hand side. Unfortunately, my pointer I cannot see here on the screen. Maybe you see it. I'll try. Yeah, so you see cell replacement is one very prominent and important and apparent application. Then the remyelination in direction of spinal cord injury, and for very rare demyelination diseases such as Pelizaeus-Merzbacher disease. And in the third group of neurological disorders where cell therapy can be applied is something where the graft really goes into communication with the host tissue, and that's here classified as promotion of host tissue regeneration, which is very important in the application, for example, of Parkinson's disease, ALS, here also spinal cord injury, and together with remyelination for multiple sclerosis. And then there's a fourth potential field of application that's for lysosomal storage disorders, where stem cells, grafted cells in general, can be used as vehicles to transport lysosomal enzymes to the site of injury and to replace the lack of lysosomal enzymes there. And then finally, also tumor-localized chemotherapy production in the case of brain tumors, where also stem cells can be used as vehicles for the delivery of prodrugs. So what I thought would be of interest for you is that I really focus here on one application, which will be for multiple sclerosis, where we have a very particular novel way of bringing stem cells into clinical realization. And we'll also particularly spend time on the source of the cells, so the stem cells as such. Where does these cells come from, and what might be the best source of cells for the therapeutic delivery, because that's something which is also of high interest for other tissues and organs. Therefore, I divided my presentation into three parts. First part will be source of allogeneic cells, primarily human pluripotent stem cells. In the second part, I will talk about a novel source of transplantable cells that can be produced by direct conversion or direct cellular reprogramming. And as said, in the final part, we'll then focus on one particular application for multiple sclerosis, and here particularly immune modulation in an EAE model. Yeah, let me start with the first part, human pluripotent stem cells. So these are actually very promising, attractive source of cells for transplantation into every tissue. They can be derived from early stages of mammalian embryos, as you can see here. That's usually the time point of blastocyst formation. That is, with human beings, about 4 to 5 days, where one can take the inner CELMoD cells and bring them into cell culture in order to get pure populations of pluripotent stem cells or ES cells. And the wonderful possibilities, opportunities that one have with those cells is here very nicely schematically shown, that you can produce any sort of cell type of the adult human being in a cell culture dish. And among those are many different cell types that are of high biomedical interest, not only in the neural system, but also in the mesodermal system, and also endodermal cells, and in particular also germ cells can produce from such kind of pluripotent stem cells. As you, I think, know, there is a second source of such kind of pluripotent stem cells for human beings since a few years now, and that was discovered by Shinya Yamanaka, who was able to show that you can use four transcription factors, SOX2, OPT4, c-MYC, KLF4, and these transcription factors are sufficient to reprogram any sort of cells into so-called iPS cells. That stands for induced pluripotent stem cells that are functionally totally equivalent to embryonic stem cells. This means you can take from a patient, for example, from the skin or the blood via biopsy cell culture, and can reprogram those with the four Yamanaka factors to get ES-like cells. And as said, it was one decade, 1 year ago, and still we and people in the field are developing, trying to bring those iPS cells into clinics, and it still needs to be shown whether we really have a biomedical revolution or whether it's just a new tool in the lab. Yeah, so as said, source of allogeneic cells, human pluripotent stem cells. Sorry. That's how we. I maybe have here some audio in the background. I hope you can hear me still. That is how we get the skin biopsy that we usually do from the patient. Here it's in control from a master student in the lab, where we derive via skin biopsy fibroblast cells in the culture that you can see here on the right-hand side. And these are then, after 2 weeks of culture approximately, they are transduced with the Yamanaka factors that you can see here on top, these black polycystronic constructs. I don't want to go too much into the molecular biology. We are using viruses, but also non-viral methods to make iPS cells out of the fibroblasts. And in this time-lapse movie, you can now see appearance of colonies with early pluripotency markers in red and late pluripotency in green. And we need then to show that those cells are indeed pluripotent, what can be done by immunohistochemistry on the left-hand side top, and left-hand side, right-hand side top, you see a bioinformatic analysis of such kind of reprogrammed cells that shows us that our colonies that we isolate after reprogramming from the patient are indeed very, very similar to human ES cells, so to pluripotent stem cells. When we want to get this into clinics, one needs usually also upscaling of the cultures, and that's a system where we have to change from the classical lab scale to bioreactors that are usually used in the clinics. And here you see an application or publication where we showed that one can upscale from a normal two-dimensional six-well culture that we have in the lab, that we can upscale to a 3-liter bioreactor. And that can be done by harvesting the cells and bring them into aggregation culture, and then taking those cells into big scale volumes that are then sufficient for the production of sufficient numbers of cells. He has shown how these cells grow. They grow as aggregates of pluripotent cells. And actually, as you can see here, don't want to go too much into it because it's published, we can freely scale the volume between 50 ml and 3 liter and can make a final harvest of 1 to the 9 human pluripotent stem cells from 1 liter of cells, which is actually the scale that one needs for various stem cell applications. So with that, we have a novel source of transplantable cells from the patient, in this case, exemplified by a Parkinson's disease patient. One can derive via skin biopsy cells from this patient and reprogram with the Feuermann-Hurkacz factors, derived from its then patient-specific induced pluripotent stem cells that can be then used into two different directions, either for disease modeling, where those cells are the basis of an unlimited source of patient-specific cells of interest, in this case, dopaminergic neurons that are differentiated from the iPS cells that one can use for drug screening and study of the pathophysiology of the cells. And one can use it also for cell therapy in an autologous manner, where one redifferentiates the cells in the wanted cell type and transplant it back into the patient. So before we come to the clinical application, one cell type, which is of a modification, which is very particular for us, has to do with the limitation of the system. As you can imagine, the production of iPS cells and also maintenance and quality control is quite laborious and costly. And here you see a timescale that shows you that about 6 months is the duration that one needs for the production of iPS cells and 1 to 2 months for the redifferentiation into the wanted cell type. And in total, that means it's very time-consuming, laborious, and costly. Therefore, we also have risk of teratoma formation because the iPS cells can give rise to teratoma. And therefore, we asked us some time ago to modify the reprogramming to achieve a defined proliferating intermediate. What leads me to the next part of the presentation is there a novel source of stem cells that can be produced by cellular reprogramming, but by direct neural conversion. And that has to do with another type of stem cells that is present in the body. As you know, pluripotent stem cells do not exist in the adult body. They are somehow artificial and therefore harbor a risk also after transplantation. Whereas, as you know, somatic stem cells do an excellent job in the regeneration of the body. And the question is, can one generate not only the induced pluripotent stem cells, as Yamanaka did, but also induced somatic stem cells, like somatic skin cells or neural stem cells or hematopoietic stem cells? And since this is a hematology and oncology meeting, I just show you this very recent publication from last year, from this week's Nature issue, where it has been shown that indeed this is possible. The answer is yes, one can produce somatic stem cells, and here particularly hematopoietic stem cells, by very particular cellular reprogramming, where a combination of transcription factors and transplantation into the corresponding niches in the body results in the generation of mature hematopoietic stem cells that could be used for the application in the clinics. But I would like to come back to the neural system. We did this direct conversion to neural stem cells, in this case already some time ago, where we modified the Yamanaka procedure means we could reprogram cells, fibroblast cells, not to induced pluripotent iPS cells, but to neural stem cells, just by changing one of the factors and applying a neural induction media to the cells. And by that, we were able to derive novel colony-type cells that we could stabilize in cell culture. And these markers that you see here staining against senescent, OLEG2, SOX2, for example, shows that these cells are very similar to neural stem cells that can be produced from primary tissue, but here for the first time by direct conversion from patient-specific fibroblasts. Here one sees that these cells can be taken into culture for more than 50 passages now. They do not change the phenotype and they are stably reprogrammed, what one can measure by the silencing of the reprogramming transgenes. And here you see in C that the induced neural stem cells, that is how we named them, are very similar to neural stem cells that you produce from primary tissue. And actually, we have they are functionally totally equivalent. We see no difference between the artificial induced neural stem cells and the primary ones. This data now shows that one can produce not only from mice but also from human cells. Here again, these very nice colonies showing in G, H, and I, showing that human neural stem cells can be artificially directly converted from fibroblasts in the cell culture dish. And also to mention, we adapted this reprogramming technology not only to adult dermal fibroblasts, but also to peripheral blood cells in the meantime and also pancreatic fibroblasts. So we have a lot of different reprogram conversion possibilities that one can help us to derive patient-specific cells from by direct conversion. Yeah, here you see for the human cells that they also recapitulate all markers of neural stem cell identity. And they also can give rise to the differentiated neural progeny, neurons on the left-hand side and astrocytes on the right-hand side at the bottom. And that shows that in terms of the cell source, we have several ways of producing transplantable cells in our days. It's not only the iPS reprogramming. That's not only the derivation from the blastocyst, but also the iPS reprogramming that allows us to produce human pluripotent stem cells. And these can be then used to differentiate these into neural progenitor cells, and then from there to neurons or glia. And the novel approach is the direct conversion from somatic cells to induced neural stem cells also to induce neurons that I have no time to talk about, but even that cellular reprogramming is doable. And in particular, the direct conversion to the iNSCs is highly preferred because it's relatively short with 1 to 2 months. These cells are highly proliferative. There's no teratoma formation and autologous iNS cells are possible by that because that's something which is of course not doable by blastocyst cells. And with the iPS reprogramming, it would be too costly and too long to apply this in the patient at the end. So what can one now do with the cells? That's will be topic of the last part for this model of multiple sclerosis and immune modulation in the EIE model. But let me first talk about not only the efficacy of such kind of reprogrammed cells for neural cell therapy, but also the safety. And here you see a very nice study published by Gao et al., which also recapitulate studies that we generated independently. And this group systematically analyzed the tumorigenic potential of reprogrammed cells and pluripotent cells in an animal model. And here you see an outcome of the transplantation experiments of ESCs and iPSCs into mouse brains, and you see apparent tumor formation. The question is now, what happens with our induced neural stem cells? And as you see, the induced neural stem cells, they do not form tumors, as the same is true for primary NSCs that directly were derived from the brain tissue. If you look at the survival curves, you see that that has also statistical relevance that here in black shown the induced neural stem cells together with mesenchymal stem cells that have been analyzed do not result in apparent tumor formation and result in a relatively stable survival of the animals. So apparently these cells appear to be safety, at least more safe than the iPSCs or ESCs. So now coming to a clinical or preclinical validation of the cells that is now here being used for modulation of EIE mice. You might know that EIE is a quite straightforward model for the disease modeling of multiple sclerosis in mice. And what we did here is that we transplanted reprogrammed iNSCs into chronic EIE mice that had been transplanted. And if you see at F, you see the clinical score of the EIE mice, which characteristically goes up to a level of about 3. And then stays there between 2.5 and 3 for quite a long time, showing the chronic immunization by factors that result in the chronic disease and also behavioral pathophysiologically in the animals. When we transplant our iNSCs, in this case syngenic cells, from the animal in black, you see the clinical score drops and results in long-lasting amelioration of EIE scores. When you look in the brain, what the cells are doing in this model, we see that most of the cells are still quite immature, and they partly form neuron-like structure cells, as you can see here in B, or maybe also astrocytes. And some of them are closely associated to blood vessel, as you can see here in E. Then we looked more closely whether or not the cells have an impact on the formation of other cell types, in particular immune cells, because there's a strong immune component in EIE and multiple sclerosis. And as you can see, there's no effect on T cells and B cells, but phagocytes are significantly decreased and after transplantation, and one can see this in both in brain but also spinal cord. And then we asked what might be the mechanisms about that, that phagocytes are somehow modulated and downregulated directly after the transplantation. And since the microenvironment is particularly controlled by the metabolic state of the cells after or the tissue after transplantation, we used an unbiased metabolic profiling by LC-MS. And here you see in M the outcome of the profiling, where you see with the PBS control, this means no injection of iNSCs after the immunization. We have an upregulation of certain metabolites that are known to play a role in immune activation and activation of the immune system. And in the case of the iNSCs, we see a significant downregulation of those markers 30 days after transplantation of the iNSCs. So obviously, the iNSCs modulate the immune system, at least such kind of metabolic markers. And now with the iNSCs, we were able to look more closely into the in vitro and co-cultures of iNSCs and macrophages derived from the same animal, and could observe that factors that are important for the intracellular transport of one of those metabolites, in particular succinate, are upregulated, as you can see here after transplantation in with the black and the gray columns. And we used a succinate reporter mutant where as a control showing that there's no upregulation. And the same is also true for human-induced neurostem. So obviously, we have an upregulation of this of the succinate reporter machinery by transplantation of the of new stem cells into the host. And if you look more closely, then what is extracellular, intracellular located in the host in the transplanted cells, we see that in particular the succinate in cells in C is upregulated and highly increased, whereas the supernatant extracellular in the supernatant is downregulated. This means this immunomodulatory molecule is trapped by from the microenvironment. And then we think that it's due to the fact that iNSCs upregulate the corresponding reporter machinery, and they act as succinate scavengers to deplete the microenvironment from the extracellular pool, and by that downregulating the inflammatory molecules in the microenvironment. Yeah, let me summarize this: the transplantation of iNSCs or NSCs, as well as functionally equivalent and ameliorating chronic inflammation. These newer stem cells reduce extracellular succinate in the CSF of EIE mice after transplantation and reset the metabolism of type 1 macrophages to an anti-inflammatory phenotype in co-culture. And I showed you that succinate activates the receptor on NSCs to initiate the secretion of prostaglandin. That's something that I had not time to show you, but that's the next step of the mechanism, and also scavenging of extracellular succinate. And the loss of function of the succinate receptor in NSCs show reduced anti-inflammatory activities in vitro and in vivo after transplantation. In the first part, I showed you that the induced transdifferentiated directly converted iNSCs can be produced from peripheral blood cells, but also fibroblast cells. They are tripotent and can self-renew. You can cryopreserve them. They can be derived from patients in less than 2 months. And in contrast to iPS cells, they form no teratoma. And by that, the iNSCs represent the most novel and promising autologous source of transplantable cells. And I showed you also a preclinical validation for that kind of iNSCs that we are currently also adapting to human cells in order to bring this also to clinical realization in the future. And the same is true also for the application in Parkinson's disease, where cell replacement is also a very promising and attractive tool, in particular for the autologous induced neural stem cells as a second example to the world of cell therapy with reprogrammed cells. Yeah, with that, I would like to thank also my co-workers that helped here in doing the work with the reprogramming and the preclinical validation, and also our cooperators, that's particularly the lab of Stefano Placino from the University of Cambridge, who did and helped with the immunomodulation, and also the lab of Andreas Trump, where we cooperate with the transdifferentiation of the fibroblast and blood cells. And I thank you for the attention. I hope it was clear and good to understand for you, and would be happy to answer questions if you have. Thank you.